organization of this meeting. It is an honor for me to be here on behalf of all members of the Sardinia Study to speak about David and about starting from that title. I want to give some explanation why an honor received. But David received some years ago the honorary citizenship by the town of Lanusei, which is the core town where the Sardinia project has been performed. These are the motivations of the resolution conferring this citizenship to David, and it is an indication of the high respect that he has in this area, and I mean, the initial source of this of everything related to Sardinia is my friend and colleague Giuseppe Filia, was mentioned before, has been a close collaborator of David, and actually Giuseppe has been the link between me and David. I first met David many years ago during his visit to Giuseppe, and I was immediately impressed by the quality of the science, the integrity of that person, and the nice approach with people in Sardinia. And then, during the last 10 years, I had the fortune to a close relationship with David on daily basis, I'll say. But I want then to comment on the other part of the title of my talk. Why genetic studies in Sardinia? Why David with Giuseppe spend big energies and time on this project? Let me briefly give a flavor of what we do and about the Sardinian population. So it is an ancient, Sardinia is an island in the middle of the Mediterranean Sea, and it is an ancient island in terms of human presence, because it has been, there is a radiocarbon dating evidence on archaeological sites that Sardinia initially populated in the Paleolithic time about 15,000 years ago. The number of sites increased during the Neolithic time, about 8,000 years ago, and reached a considerable density in the Bronze Age. And this is witnessed by a huge number of these stone towers. There are currently 7,000 of these prehistoric stone towers that have been built about 4,000 years ago. That indicates also that the density of the population was quite large, because we think that there were about 15,000 of these towers 1,000 years ago. Certainly there was not one person per tower, so there was a considerable demographic density in the population. And also the fortune to read some notes that David shared with me about his first impressions during his visit in Sardinia about these towers. They were very deep in size, and never banal. They were always trying to understand something that was not obvious, actually. And so this population, I don't like to be self-referential, but at an objective measure, it is an interesting population, because basically, as you can see here from an old slide run by a colleague, Laura Morelli, worked with me for many years, this is 20 years old, using the white chromosome, so you can see that each color is a lineage marked by a specific SNP, a combination of SNPs. And you see that in Sardinia there are lineages that are common in Western Europe, but also in Eastern Europe, plus some variants, some lineages that are very rare as well in Europe that tend to be more common in Sardinia. More recently, we had the possibility to use sequence data from thousands of people the complete sequence of the human genomes, including the Y chromosome, to reconstruct the phylogeny of the Y chromosome, going back in each mutational step, and using also a rare lineage that has been introduced. This is an African lineage that has been introduced in Sardinia about 2,000 years ago through the introduction of slaves from Africa during the Roman Empire. So we managed to go back to the origin of modern humans about 200,000 years ago. It was actually 100,000 years before then what was proposed for the Y chromosome was fully consistent with the estimations done on mitochondrial DNA. So currently, using genetic variation and placing genetic variation in a Cartesian system, you can see that Sardinia are a population state where it is indicated by geography, and enlarging this analysis to other Mediterranean places, population like these are Bedouins, these are Levant population like Israel, for example, this is Iran, and Sardinia is here, and these are the past, these are the closest population. But let me say that now we have a tool that allow us to directly test, not only to use the DNA of contemporary people as a register, as a record of mutation, and allow us to go back in time and reconstruct past events. But we can directly test this using ancient DNA, especially DNA extracted from the Petrus bones, especially enriched in DNA, using the methods to capture ancient DNA, basically in solution, like capture hybridization method that allows to assess small fragments of DNA and resequence them and assess 1 million variants in past samples. Now, consider this is this principal component analysis in ancient DNA. Now this will become gray and we superimpose ancient DNA extracted over the last 15,000 years. So this is the contemporary stuff, this is the ancient DNA. What is really interesting is that if you consider, for example, early Neolithic farmers from across Europe, from Anatolia, from Iberia, from different parts of Europe, you immediately see that the closest contemporary population is Sardinia. So basically, Sardinia is capturing one, and perhaps the main component of the basal component of the contemporary European population. And so we started to do some analysis of ancient DNA in collaboration with colleagues like John Novembre, and archaeologists, other people like Cosimo Post working in Johannes Krauss' group, Magdalena Joindreska, a colleague in our institute, and we started to collect the ancient DNA samples. These are the first 29, but we have an additional 50 samples providing the same results. If we repeat the same analysis using this ancient DNA from Sardinia and other samples from across Europe, again, they all lie along the contemporary Sardinia. If we do a super zoom of the Sardinian population, this is really focusing just on Sardinia, and you see that you have this kind of shape in which here is the variation present in the main areas of Sardinia, including the Cagliari area, the main town in Sardinia, and this area in another close to a town named Oristano, and then this part of Sardinia, there is the second town, main town in Sardinia, they are all here. Here is what we have in this internal area, including the Barbagia area and the Ogliastra area where we run our study. And we found that all ancient samples going back to 9,000 years ago, they fall here. This indicates, first of all, lack of temporal switch over 10,000 years from the initial founder population. Secondly, that all the differentiation we see here is from a common pool, genetic pool, and it is due to genetic fit, not to different people arriving in these areas. So these are the key features of the Sardinian population that we have been discussing for many years. With David, now we have some direct evidence indicating some of the models that we've been discussing. And this is interesting because it allows us also to conclude that, what we found in Sardinia is not a kind of local curiosity, peculiarity that is relevant for Sardinia, but it could be relevant for any European derived population. So these are the main goals of what we do. We don't want to produce a list of genes and variants. We want to use genes to understand biology of interesting traits and to understand better the pathophysiology of diseases and of aging, and to understand better the mechanisms and pathways that possibly to find therapeutic targets. So we study both diseases, could be relevant in Sardinia using classical case control studies, and also we study quantitative traits. And we want to try to study these two things together. So basically, we collected the case control samples from across the island. I will explain later why we place a special effort on immunity, type 1 diabetes, multiple sclerosis, and controls from across the island. And we focus on this malaria to study quantitative traits to the Sardinia project, and not going to speak about this because David will speak later about this, just to say that the project began in 2001 with Giuseppe Piglia, with the critical help, support of David. And it is a slide to show that Giuseppe with David, and I mean, with key people, this is was Giuseppe's mother, Anna, and his sister, Maria Grazia, who had a different level, a great role, contributed enormously to the success of that project. This is the mentor of Giuseppe and myself, Professor Cao. This is a slide with David, with Anna, and Giuseppe's mother. We have many very nice occasions to share time with her during the many visits that we receive from David. So basically, what we do, of course, we try to have a good extraction of the genetic information in a parsimonious way. So using a cost-effective approach, we sequence the whole genome in a subset of the people we analyze, that are about 20,000 people, or the people who have been typed with high-density arrays, and we created a reference panel, a population-specific reference panel, to try to infer the sequences of the genome, even the people that have not been sequenced, but have been, genotyping data. And in fact, we create, through this panel of 23 million SNPs and 3 million intels, the probability sequences in all the people that we study. These are some people. This was a visit in Michigan, and this is a key collaborator, Gonzalo Pecchesis, Carlo Sidore, works in our team, and I don't need to say who are these two guys here. And applying this approach, actually, we assess several interesting traits, for example, lipid levels, inflammatory markers, variants affecting stature, and hemoglobin levels. We have the fortune to publish 3 papers and receive some news and views and they're covering Nature Genetics. And a few months ago, we were celebrating these results in Gonzalo's house in Michigan. Honestly, we don't need to publish 3 papers to celebrate. We celebrate many times. For example, here is that La Carta filling sunglasses. I don't remember if it is Diet Coke or wine. I guess it is most likely red one. And I had the fortune again to visit many places with David, to have fun, to discuss about science, about art, about many things. This is a very nice restaurant. We were going into this restaurant named Tadish Grill. It's a Croatian restaurant in San Francisco that, of course, David suggested, and it was a great experience. I recommend this restaurant. But apart from food, also we went during this year to many museums, like yesterday with some friends in Detroit, I guess. One of these visits, and I must say that David has been an exceptionally competent guide in these tours, much better than a professional one, I must say. And he was impressive, the way in which he was presented, discussing anything, paintings and various forms of art we saw. So, but let me briefly give a flavor also about a specific area that we have been investigating. This is the Immunity Autoimmunity Project. Why we focus on autoimmunity? Because in Sardinia, as you can see here, for a slide about the prevalence of multiple sclerosis, there is a high prevalence. Actually, Sardinia is the main exception to the north-south gradient in prevalence across Europe. Consider that multiple sclerosis is more common in Europe than any other place. It's a typical disorder of European and European direct population. And Sardinia is clearly an exception to this prevalence. Actually, the real prevalence now is 350. So there are 6,400 people with multiple sclerosis in a population of 1.5 million. Again, a similar trend is observed for type 1 diabetes. The incidence, the highest incidence in the world, along with Finland. So what we decided to do is to, in addition to the search of variants, genetic variants affecting the disease, was also to assess systematically through an hypothesis-generating approach a quantitative traits represented by levels in the blood of immune cells and their products, cytokines, immunoglobulins. And in an approach that is different from observational studies that compare variables in patients versus control that could be prone to biases, in particular to reverse causation effects, which is the worst type of bias, because there is a confusion between the consequence of a disease and the causes of the disease. And we didn't invent nothing. This was the first thought by Ronald Fisher more than 100 years ago. This was there. So we want really to try to find the coincident genetic associations, so specific points, specific DNA variants, affecting both the risk for disease and influencing the levels of specific solubles in the peripheral blood. This is why we started with Eduardo Valeria and other colleagues, Ilan Uzei, a systematic approach to assess the immune system, assessing an initial proof of concept study about 95 type cell types, focusing on broad subtypes like B, T cells, natural killer, monocytes, and then with an emphasis on regulatory cells, dendritic cells, and the maturation status of these cells. We established that these immune traits are evitable because it was under question. Many people said, okay, there is variation in level of cells, but most of these, or nearly all of this, is due to viruses and other environmental factors. We discovered that 40% of the variation is due to genes with some traits that have the same irritability of white. About 80%, these are some fine molecules regulating other cells. We found 23 variants at 13 loci with the tracking effect in this pilot study. And also we showed that actually there were some of these variants that were affecting both the autoimmunity risk, but also levels of cell, which was the initial hypothesis we want to test. we published this work some years ago, again immediately after we have been this nice tour to Japan, we experienced the exceptional hospitality of Minoru Ko, who is here in the audience. Thank you again for this. And we were discussing with David the possibility to use this information to create the humanized knocking mice, to create some features of the immune system in animal models in collaboration with the Leken Institute. And this was Osamu Ohara, who is a researcher of the Leken Institute. But what we are doing now, we expanded the number of traits and molecules studied, using, for example, also surface receptor to the medium fluorescent intensity, and considering many cell types like monocyte B cells and other mucosal immunity cells in the peripheral blood, currently assessing 4,000 quantitative traits. We found a huge number of genetic associations. We moved from 13 to more than 200, and the coincident association with disorder are not anymore 4, more than 20. And I want to briefly conclude with an example of this coincident association we published. This Maristella Stella and Laura Ida was here in the audience, contributed a lot to this paper. It started from an observation that there is a gene named TNF-13B encoded as cytokine buff, which is associated with multiple sclerosis. It was interesting because it encodes the cytokine. Is clearly a drug target, and it is a key molecule regulating the proliferation, differentiation, survival of the cells in a period in which everyone speaking about multiple sclerosis was considering this disease a problem of T cells. In fact, this association was suggested that it was there was a relevant contribution of B cells, but we didn't want make this inference based on the name of the gene. So we started, first of all, expanding this observation and having a very significant association in this region with MS. Then we measure in the peripheral blood soluble BAFF, not in patients, in an independent general population control, because we think that assessing something that in patients is always potentially confusing because it can have a consequence of the disease. And we found that exactly the same variant that was affecting multiple sclerosis risk was controlling level really cracking way, because having one copy of this allele implies 20% more of the protein in the blood, having two copies, 40% more of this protein. The same variant was associated also with an increase of B cells. This is a kind of, we call locus zoom. There are 10,000 variants in this gene region. And we were very lucky because one was clearly dominating the association with all these traits, including levels of immunoglobulins and monocyte level that were reduced. We don't know yet if this is due to a feedback because they produce this cytokine or because BAFF can also transform monocytes into peripheral dendritic cells. Assessing the transcriptome, we saw that it affects also levels of mRNA, but this explains only about 25% of variation we see at the protein level. Importantly, we saw that this variant is located in QTR of the gene, is making an alternative polyadenosine site, making shorter the transcript. This is an homozygous people for the variant, heterozygous and homozygous wild type. And in close collaboration with Vivian Korosky, who is here, we performed many functional tests, including RNA pull down, luciferase assays, inhibition and hyperexpression experiments in both cell lines and primary cells, showing that actually This variant is the causal variant, that the shorter form is missing a site or binding microRNA, particularly of the family of MIRNA-15A, but that explains part of this association, maybe at the post-transcriptional level, but there are now in the follow-up also RNA binding protein that affect this increased expression due to this variant. But the key factor is the shorter transcript lacks a site of inhibition from microRNA and RNA binding protein, so there is an enhanced expression of the gene. This is a summary statistic, but to conclude, I want also to say that we observe not only an association with multiple sclerosis and systemic lupus, but also that the variant is increasing frequency in Sardinia versus southern Italy and especially versus North Europe. So we wonder whether this was just a drift, a random effect, or was due to selection. We have now tools, agnostic tools, to try to test if a variant becomes common just by chance or because it has been useful over the evolutionary history of that population. These are differentiation tests in which we select variants with similar features across the genome, and we see, for example, if they differentiate in different populations the same way, and this variant was an outlier. But the mother, I mean, the most informative test is to see there was a longer core haplotype around the variant. And in fact, as you can see here, this is the case. So, an applying specific test, we demonstrated that actually this variant that is now a risk factor for autoimmunity has been extremely useful. The next question is why. We thought that malaria, which was highly prevalent in Sardinia until 60 years ago, it has been actually eradicated through a project named the Sardinian Project. It's similar to the name of our project by the Rockefeller Foundation in 1952. And we thought that malaria could be a key agent because a transgenic mouse model of BAF, which is similar to the human model we have in Sardinia, survived after lethal infection with the eroded model of malaria, the Plasmodium aureum. So we have also, of course, a strong interest in strongly stimulated by David on immunosenescence because it is part of the study of aging. For example, we show that BAF, the same cytokine affecting autoimmunity, shows an increase over time in females. So not only we have an age-related effect, but a gender-related effect. We see the cross-sectional trajectory of these 150 cell types from 18 years to more than 100 years. And also, focus on absolute counts, we see that, of course, most of the cells of the immune system decrease over life. But there are some specific cells that increase, actually. And these are especially interesting because, again, these are absolute counts. It cannot be related to reshuffling of cells and increase of some of them. These are some statistics saying, I mean, the effect of these cells over life. To conclude my talk, I think I want to briefly say something that we want to use this genetic information in the route of our drug discovery, and I think that we can impact, especially at the initial stages, in the definition of targets, and in creating assays test modulating compounds. This is not easy. We try to establish some criteria that in a paper that is impressive, we did publish soon in Trends in Genetics, we wrote with David and our two colleagues. But these are some of our recommendations to take advantage of this information. We think that it's really a super powerful tool, genetics, to improve the success in drug development. And the conditions are to place an emphasis on finding intermediate phenotypes, something that you can measure that is genetically linked with the disease, to a complex procedure starting from coincident genetic associations, exactly like those that I showed before, finding the causal gene and related protein target, reinforcing causal relationship, and many tests that could be time-consuming, solving pleiotropic effect, because this will be one of the main challenges we will have to face, not our group, everyone studying genetics in the following years, because we know now that a variant can affect not only a specific protein and a specific trait, but can have multiple effects on different traits, and then it is very relevant to solve this effect to the causal disease-related effect, and taking into account that, of course, that if you want to establish a drug, you need ideally through the inhibition of something which is protective, so reproducing an experiment in nature therapeutically, need to take into account also side effects and, I mean, to establish which genes are essential and to which extent you can down-modulate the expression of the gene. And we have now tools to solve this pleiotropic effect. For example, if you have one variant associated with one disease and many traits, you might have in another point of the genome the association with the same disease, but just with one trait. So you can refine to a causal trait that could be level of cells of the soluble molecules, just to the causal one. These are my conclusions for the talk, but the main conclusion is that I really want to say thank you to David for many things, in particular for being during these years continuously present being certainly a kind of lighthouse, intern, a lighthouse, a cold shower, alarm clock, master planner, his great sense of organization, but above all, a person of exceptional integrity and a teacher who leads by example. This really has been a fortune. This is David with our team in Danuse, with other Sardinia colleagues, Antonello Pano is here. And I want to extend my thank you to Alice. They were working very quickly. I was left behind. As you know, it's quite quick. And I took the opportunity to keep up on the end. Thank you very much.